everyone would stand and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Scott, if you could do roll.
I can see we have everybody here. President Branstad.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
I am here. Treasurer Wasserman.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Frazee.
Here.
Member Gordon.
Here.
Everybody's here.
All right. Excellent. Welcome everyone who's joined us out in the audience tonight. First thing tonight is we have our consent agenda. I'll quickly go through the items. 2.1 is approval of the meeting minutes from our November 21st regular meeting. 2.2 are staff members who have announced their resignation. 2.3 are persons recommended for employment for this school year. 2.4 is our 2016-17 Advisory Board on Instruction in Sex Education and Birth Control. 2.5 is the administration recommending the purchase of a 2017 John Deere subcompact tractor. 2.6 is approval of the payment of the school's bills for the month of October. And 2.7 are legal invoices for payment. This time I would entertain a motion.
So moved.
Move by Jerry.
Support.
Support by Pam. Is there any discussion?
I think $98 is a record low in legal expenses in my tenure on this board. That is shockingly low. It's wonderful.
Is that 10 minutes?
It was a phone call.
That's what it was.
It was.
That's exactly what it was.
Yeah, Scott, what would that be? All right. Any other discussion? All right. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? All right. Consent agenda passes. Moving into Board of Education matters. First, we have our December Shining Stars.
Mike. We have a couple real nice ones to recognize today. First is Sarah DeGroat. Sarah would come up. And while Sarah's coming up and stands with me, I'll read a little bit about Sarah. Sarah earned her Bachelor of Arts degree from Saginaw Valley State University in 2000 and her Master's from Saginaw Valley State University in May of 2004. Ms. DeGroat joined the Midland Public School staff in 2000 as a first and second grade classroom teacher at Parkdale Elementary. During her MPS career, she has taught at Chestnut Hill, Woodcrest, Cook, and served as a Beadle and a 6+1 traits trainer. Upon the closure of Cook Elementary in 2010, Ms. DeGroat moved to Adams Elementary as a kindergarten teacher as the role she continues today. And this is the special part. Sarah was nominated for the Shining Star by parents and an MPS colleague. Among their comments they wrote, during the course of the day in the fall, one of her students came to her unable to breathe. Ms. DeGroat asked if he was choking. The student was able to respond with a head nod. Ms. DeGroat immediately administered the Heimlich to the student, expelling the item on which he was choking on, and potentially saving the child's life. She is always enthusiastic about teaching, organized and well-prepared. Her class is very structured and always keeps the kids busy. She never shows frustration, even in a tough situation. When I ask about my child, she responds very quickly, provides lots of information, and tries to work out the problems. I feel she has integrity and fairness. She is the best teacher. Her ability to monitor and recognize each student is to be commended. Ms. DeGroat is a motivated educator, and it is evident that she truly enjoys her profession and seeks ways of bringing the joy of learning to her students' experiences. Congratulations, Sarah.
Thank you so much. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Our second shining star is Vivian, if I mispronounce your name, you got a whole, excuse me for that, Leeski. Okay. Vivian's MPS journey began before her employment. She is a graduate of H.H. Dow High School. Viv was hired as a library aide in 1974 at Jefferson Intermediate School, which means she has been a member of the MPS staff for 42 years. Viv is one of only a handful of 40-hour per week paraprofessionals. Viv's entire 42-year career has been at Jefferson. She has served in just about every paraprofessional role, library, locker room, and morning coordinator and noon supervisor, office, classroom, and special education. For the past several years at Jefferson, Viv's assignment included assistance in working with special education students, paperwork, and timeliness. While at Siebert Elementary office was in a recent period of transition, Viv was asked to help fill in for a good portion of her day for several weeks. Viv was a knowledgeable, helpful, smiling faces to the students, staff, families, and visitors who entered the office during that time. Viv was nominated for the Shining Star by two MPS colleagues. Among their comments were the following. Viv pitched in and was a huge help as Siebert dealt with several weeks of office transition. Viv stepped into the office at Siebert like she had been there for years. Viv's experience is vast and her positive attitude is genuine. Viv recently spent several weeks helping out at Siebert. She did this while keeping up with her duties as a paraprofessional at Jefferson. Viv has always gone above and beyond for the Midland Public Schools for over 40 years. Congratulations, Viv.
All right, moving into our next item, that would be the Midland High presentation from their Electronics Club.
Mr. Jaster, introduce our guest.
Okay. Good evening. Mr. Sheriff, Board of Education, thanks for having us tonight and giving us the opportunity to highlight one of our outstanding student clubs. The Midland High School Wireless and Electronics Communication Club is one of over 30 clubs at Midland High School, and I think what makes this one somewhat unique is that it gives students the opportunity to practice and put into play some of the things that they learn in the classroom. So the extensions of their learning are evident, and you'll see that in the presentation shortly. I'd like to introduce the two co-advisors for the club first, Mr. Andrew Fawcett. He is a physics teacher in the building, and Andrew, I think you've been there for 20 years, is that right? Yeah. And then Dr. Dennis Klippa, who is a retired organic chemist and researcher from Dow Chemical, and he spent over 30 years researching for Dow Chemical. He's had an interest in electronics and wireless communication since he was a young student himself, and so I'm going to bring him up first to introduce students and to give some other background about this club.
Thank you. And thanks for the opportunity to talk about the Electronics and Wireless Communications Clubs, which are educational programs of the Midland Amateur Radio Club. And I'm going to tell you about how we came to where we are, a little bit about why we do this, and then we've got three students with us tonight who are going to tell you what we actually do and talk a little bit about that. In 2004, Dennis Caney, another amateur radio operator, partnered up with Jennifer Lennon to form the Central Middle School Amateur Radio Club, and I joined that effort a few years after that. When we learned that Central Middle School was going to close, we had a decision to make. Were we going to go to another middle school, or were we going to go to the high school? And we decided that what we wanted to do was go to the high school level, start a club there, and then when we had that established, go back to the middle school. So when Central closed, before Central closed, we approached Janet Greif and Linda Klein and pitched the club idea. They were very receptive and supportive of that. So we started our club. We're now in our fourth year at the high school with Mr. Fawcett as our faculty advisor. We decided last year we were established well enough. We approached Bernadette Wood and Carmen Kessler at Northeast Middle School, and we started our second club there last year. We have this year we have 30 students in that club. We have 10 students in the high school club. So we're very happy with that level of success. Why do we do this? Well, there's two reasons why I do it. One is a big picture reason, and one's a more personal reason. And the big picture reason is, if you look around the world that we live in, it's an electronic world. Everything is electronic. The projector, the controls for the lights, your telephones, the TV presentation, satellites up in the air, the controllers for your microwave, your oven. Electronics are everywhere. It's a big part of our life. And while we do learn about electricity and magnetism in our physics classes, there isn't any place where we learn about electronics in our schools. And from our perspective as amateur radio operators, we see that's a gap. And because of our knowledge, it's something that we can help fill. So that's the big reason why we do this. The personal reason is that I've been an amateur radio operator since I was 15, a student in high school. And I wanted to learn. And basically everything I learned was self-taught. There wasn't anybody there who could help me learn. And with all this knowledge and experience that I've gained over the years, I feel I want to be that somebody who can provide that education, answer those tough questions, and help the students learn about electronics. So that's why I do it. Okay. To learn more about what we do, I'd like to have the three students come up. Drew Sheffer and Brendan O'Callaghan and Natalie Helfen.
So, hello, my name is Andrew Sheffer. I'm in ninth grade, but on the amateur radio, I'm known as K-E-8-E-O-U. I wanted to talk today about why I love Electronics Club and how it inspired me to go into the engineering field even more than I already was. So, about a year ago, a couple friends and I attended the first meeting, and after that first meeting, I knew I was hooked. So, one of my favorite things about the club is probably the project-based learning. It's a lot different from the classroom experience of sitting down, taking notes, then, you know, taking a test and then an exam and then repeating that process a lot. We're an electronics club. We went from building an LED flashlight to a touch-based alarm to launching a weather balloon into near space, which is out of this world. Another thing I believe brought me back every week was probably the people. I wanted to take a moment to thank the volunteers for all the time and effort they put into making this club possible. They're always willing to give help and are very generous with their time. Finally, what I really loved about the club was how it took all my favorite subjects, technology, engineering, math, science, and put them all into one cool experience. What is not apparent is that the technology we're learning about is used by most people every single day. And I wish more people had the opportunity to learn in this special way. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello there. My name is Brendan O'Callaghan. I'm a sophomore at Midland High. And I'm in the Electronics and Communications Club. I definitely like this club because not only does it help me learn about electronics and communications, but it also is a more tactile learning class, so I'm able to really absorb what I learn in it. I absolutely love working with the Arduinos and the capacitors and such and the breadboards that we work with. I'll admit, when I joined the club this year, I had absolutely zero idea what I was doing and didn't really know anything, but thanks to the wonderful staff that helped me, I've definitely got a basic idea of what I'm doing, and I really enjoy it. It's awesome. This helps me in school, definitely, because not only am I learning new things, but I'm also learning new ways to learn, such as tactilely. This also, I believe, helps me later in life, as I plan on joining the military, and I recently took the ASVAB, and the electronics and communication actually was a large part of it. And I believe that this will definitely help me with my later on careers, as not only am I learning things that will help me now for this, but also life skills later on. I definitely enjoy the helpful parts of the staff that helped me really learn for that, and the overall basis of it in which we learn, we go step by step, learning how to do this, which will help us do this, which will eventually get us to the grand scheme of launching the weather balloon into the space, I think is a great way of how we conduct this. And thank you.
Hi, I'm Natalie Helfen. I'm currently a senior at Midland High School, and some background about me is, like, in the future I want to go into computer engineering, and I've gotten accepted at Michigan Tech and Michigan State. So in this picture, this is from June of this year. We had a high altitude balloon launch, and you can see the balloon from the middle school and the high school. And you can see all the people that were involved in this. So the main components of this balloon launch, you can see the balloon. It was designed to burst at about 100,000 feet. And once it burst, the parachute that it had would help it slow down. There was also a radar reflector to allow air traffic controllers to know where the balloon was. And there was also the payload, which had many components that we built. So in the payload, we had, actually I have it right here. There were many components to it, such as a position tracker called the APRS, and there was also a radio beacon or FOX transmitter, which was backup for the position tracker in case it didn't work. There were multiple antennas, such as the GPS, the APRS, and the beacon. And sensors such as the GPS, temperature, pressure, and light. And we also programmed this all in C programming language. And there was also a camera on the payload, which was really cool because we got to see cool pictures of it up in the air. So yeah, we built that, the one that's going around right now. This is the flight paths that the balloons took. The red one is from the high school and the blue line is the middle school. And we started in Gladwin and they went all the way to around Breckenridge. We got a lot of data from our balloons. Some of it included the time, the position, altitude, the speed, direction, velocity, temperature, pressure, and light. And this is just some of the data that we collected, some of the main points. So you can see with the black line, which is the external temperature, we can tell where it entered the stratosphere because it changed slope, and that was at about 45,000 feet. And then you can tell the coldest temperature that it reached was about negative 55 degrees Fahrenheit. The orange line is the altitude, and it went up to 99,300 feet, which is where the balloon popped. And about 10 seconds after, it was going 119 miles per hour down.
Did the parachute work?
Yeah, it worked. So basically in Electronics and Wireless Communications Club, we learn a lot of things that are important for like problem solving. We learned to plan. Like we planned out what we wanted to have in the balloon launch and like the things that we wanted to measure. We learned to design, like take those ideas and turn them into how we can perform that. And then we build them. So we use components like these and then put them on the boards in order to make the components that we put in our projects. And then we test them. So like for the payload, we tested the temperature sensor by putting it by dry ice and seeing if it would measure that, or the pressure one by putting it in a vacuum chamber. And after testing them, we actually used the components that we made. So some of the things that we've done throughout this club includes like electronics, radio technology, constructing circuits. We learned to program like in C language. We use sensors, system testing, and high altitude experimentation, and we do all this while we have fun. So some cool things is in this first picture, you can see some people setting up the balloon for the balloon launch. The second picture up there, that's a picture from the actual payload while it was up in the air. This is one of the middle schoolers searching for the payload. And then the last picture is where we found it. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah.
All right. There we go.
Natalie?
Yeah.
And anybody can feel free to chime in. Were there any significant data points that were maybe surprising or unexpected that you guys encountered with the Weather Balloon Project?
Not that I remember.
There was, if I could jump in, there was one where if you look at this descent rate, as you come down lower in the atmosphere, gets thicker, so the descent rate slows down. Yep. But with the middle school balloon, about 1 mile above the ground, all of a sudden it started coming down faster. And that was unexpected. And by looking at the balloon after it landed in its construction, we were able to figure out why that happened. So that was a big surprise.
And why?
Don't keep us in suspense.
Yes, why did that happen?
The reason was the middle schoolers, and if you want to look at the pictures, middle schoolers wanted to have a mascot on their halo.
That's right.
So they had put a paint stirring stick out to it with a little monkey on it. So now, as that's coming down through the atmosphere, it acts like a propeller, and it spins the payload, and it winds up the cords till eventually it collapses the parachute. And now you have much less wind resistance.
Gotcha. All right.
Interesting.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
What are the real-world applications of using a weather balloon and all this data you're collecting? Why do you do it?
I'll answer. Well, the real-world application is not the data that we get from the weather balloon, but teaching the students that they have the ability to create technology to go out and measure things in their environment. They don't have to wait for somebody to come and tell them. Okay? They can do it on their own. Okay? So this is an example. We use a high altitude balloon launch as an excuse to explore electronics and science.
Okay.
You commented earlier that you would, through the whole program, not just the balloon launch, you know, you're evoping in stages. And it just hit me. You tested all your instrumentation, all your sensors, all your feedback loops. Did you actually test a balloon first? Was the first time you strapped a payload onto a balloon is when you launched this?
It's kind of like a bullet. You know, if you test a bullet.
Gotcha.
So how often do you meet as a club?
We meet every Tuesday.
Okay.
Oh. We meet every Tuesday night.
Do you have a next project or a next goal in mind?
Currently, we're working on the different components of the payload, such as the temperature sensor. I'm building the radar detector. We also have different other components, such as altitude. I check the altitude or check the pressure up there and along as we go. So we're building that and getting ready to launch the balloon.
Another one.
Cool.
Yeah, both the high school and the middle school will be launching balloons again. And last year, we used a microcomputer called a PIC microcontroller, which is in everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's 2 billion of these things everywhere. This year, we're using the Arduino, which is another microcomputer-based technology. It's a little bit easier for the students to program, and I think it's going to be a much better learning experience. Something different.
Do you guys have the same target altitude, or are you going to push it higher? Or what's the goal there?
We live in Michigan. Okay, we're surrounded by water. We have no control over the balloon once it's launched.
Right? Well, I guess a better question is, are you going to use the same material or same balloon?
Same. Okay. Yeah, a similar balloon, yeah. So the idea is we need to get it up in the air and get it back down, and so all of those things play together as how far up you can take it. Okay. But 100,000, 120,000 feet is about the limit of how high you can go.
Got a question for the students. When you're at home tearing something apart, are you intrigued more with how things are built, or what have you learned anything new as far as some of the exploring you might have done because of what you've learned here?
Well, yeah, I like tearing things apart. And I think one of the biggest things that we've learned in Electronics Club is the different components inside of it. So once you see what the little components are and putting them together, it's sort of mind-blowing seeing these simple components making extraordinary things.
Like, what's an extraordinary thing?
A radio, a cell phone, anything like that.
Mm-hmm. Very neat. That's a good answer. I see the picture where you found your equipment. It looked like you were out in a farm field. Is it easy to find it? Are you following it through the camera, the electronics?
The GPS.
GPS.
Got a radio.
Sorry, what was the question?
How did you actually find the pieces that you were looking for at the end? I mean, was it you said they were searching for it. Is it difficult to find it, or are you being able to monitor that?
So it is quite difficult. We're using, as you can see right there, it's a direct antenna. So you go to different spaces, and you try to triangle. It goes directly in a line, and you sort of sweep your hand like this, and you'll find sort of a little area where it is, and then you go to a different place, do the same thing, and eventually you'll get like a point on a map, and you go there, see if you can find it easier.
Okay, thanks.
Now, we do have GPS technology that will transmit its location to us. So the plan is that we'll be able to follow it during its flight. Unfortunately, as anybody who had done science experiments, things fail. And in this flight, the GPS failed, but we had a backup system. We had actually three backup systems. And so we went to the second backup system, and that's what Andrew just described.
So Natalie, as a senior, have you been involved in this all 4 years? And did you get involved in this and then decided you wanted to go into computer engineering, or was it the opposite?
Well, I joined this club last year.
Okay.
And before this, I knew I wanted to do something with, like, computers or engineering or something. But this club, like, helped me realize that I actually did like doing it, and it was really interesting. So it helped me figure out what I liked to do more.
So with only 10 people in the group, do you do any type of recruiting to get your friends involved and show what you guys have done to drum up interest? Or is 10 pretty much a good group?
10's definitely good, but more is always better. I've been trying to get all my friends, but, you know, they're in sports and everything. So They say once they get out of sports, they'll be trying to join.
Excellent. All right, are there other questions?
I'd like to make one other comment that's related to that. This club is open to all high school students in Midland County.
Okay.
Not just Midland High, it's Dow High. We have one student from a Christian high school, we have one student who's homeschooled, and we have one student from Bullet Creek. So it's open to everybody in Midland County.
All right. And I guess to you, Dr. Philippa, thank you so much.
Thank you
for volunteering and for what you're doing for our students, and I guess all students in Midland County, based on your comment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Patrick is going to try to snag it. All right, thank you everyone for coming. All right, at this time we're moving into Board of Education Matters, presentations to the board for action, and I am up first. At this time, as we do and have done for the past several years in December, we do superintendent evaluation. And so this evening I have that to present to the board for their approval. And so at this time I will read the letter that we have written to Mike for his annual review. Dear Mike, the board reviews your prior year's performance on an annual basis. As student performance is the main goal of our district, this evaluation is completed in December to allow prior school year performance data to be used in the assessment. Your performance is judged based on several objectives, including student achievement, financial district measures, management of our bond through both the financial and construction side, and communication with all stakeholders. This evaluation is a joint opinion of all 7 of the Midland Public School board members. 2016 has been a year to be proud of for the Midland Public Schools, as has been shown through the hard work and dedication of the entire district. As the lead of our district, the board rates your performance this year in whole as exemplary. The key focus of our district is always the achievement of our students. This year, the board rates your performance for the objective as highly effective. This achievement is measured in many ways, including grade level testing, SAT scores, and IBAP scores. New this year was the alignment of teacher administrator performance in meeting and exceeding student growth measures. This is state mandated beginning in the 2016-17 school year, but the district implemented this requirement a year early. Our district continues to perform at the highest levels in our state this year. Our M-STEP results showed that MPS maintained proficiency levels 5 to 25% beyond state averages in all tested grades and subjects, with our secondary scores averaging 24% beyond state performance levels. We also have points of pride that we no longer have any of our schools designated as focus schools. This is attributed to the hard work of many in the district to close the gap between our highest and lowest performing students through multiple efforts. Our 2016 11th grade SAT results put our district in the top 5% of all districts in Michigan. We also had outstanding results for all students taking IB and AP exams this year, outpacing not only Michigan averages, but global averages for these assessments. We had 87 MPS students achieving the distinction of being named AP scholars. We are proud to note that 100% of our MPS students who attempted to earn a full IB diploma were successful. As one board member noted, as there is much focus on closing the gap by bringing the bottom up, there is also much focus on continuing the tradition of raising the bar for the top achievers, as well as evidenced by the data above. In our first year of aligning student growth to teacher-administrator performance, we are encouraged to note that 98.6% of our teaching staff of 438 received ratings of effective or highly effective. This is based on student growth measures that were set in the teacher evaluation rubric. In addition to the current year's achievement data, our district, through your leadership, is focused on the continuation of student performance growth through new programs and continual assessment of our current programs. The district has now equipped all middle and high school students with their own computing device. There is much board excitement for our new STEM curriculum through Project Lead the Way, which will expand opportunities for our students. We are excited for the implementation of IB PYP at all our elementary schools in the district. The continuation of our community schools model at the elementary level continues to show positive results. As one board member stated, MPS continues to monitor the rigor and kinds of classes that will allow our students to be prepared and successful in their futures. Curriculum will continue to change as technology and the needs of the workforce change, and we do a good job of monitoring that. This year saw the continuation of our major focus on the financials for the district. All board members rate your performance in this area at the highest levels. For the first time in several years, we not only finished the 2015-16 school year without tapping into our reserves, but we were able to put money back into our fund balance. The board appreciates your proactive approach with our school finances and the hard work with all district employees to achieve our current financial state. As one board member stated, we will continue to have challenges most years going forward due to unpredictable and ever-changing funding and mandates from Lansing and local employment shifts. But Mike has put us in a position to weather this that is fair to employees and, more importantly, the least impactful on students. After the successful passage of our bond in 2015, 2016 has been a year of progress using those funds for immediate and future student impact. The board rates you highly effective in your management of our bond proceeds and the planning and implementation of current projects. We appreciate your excellent working relationship with all parties involved, from the financial to the construction side. With so much work in progress and in the planning stages, we appreciate the frequent updates and the focus on staying on budget and on time for all projects. As one board member stated, he has been maintaining excellent communication and updates to the school and Midland community so that they can see their money at work. Communication is an important aspect of a superintendent's position. The board rates your performance in this area as effective. We appreciate the continuation of many avenues of communication that you implemented upon your arrival in our district, including the regular two-way communication with the board, parents, and the community. You continue to make sure the community is updated on the progress of our bond projects. Your ability to quickly respond during difficult times has been displayed this year, and we thank you for your sense of urgency in addressing these situations. As one board member stated, he has high ethical standards and his communications reflect those appropriately. Your community involvement is an important component of your communication for our district. As an active participant on many local boards, you are a champion for our district, and the board recognizes this and rates you highly effective in this area. Many board members commented that your participation in these community boards is a direct reflection on the support that we receive in the district from corporations, foundations, and other community partners. One board member stated, Yo and Yo personnel had comments during our audit that they don't see other districts receive the money that Midland does from donors. I believe this to be directly tied to Mike's involvement in the community. In summary, once again, the board rates your performance this year as exemplary. As one board member stated, Midland does not have to worry about school leadership with Mike as our superintendent. Another board member stated, he definitely is always thinking about what the future of MPS should look like and is not afraid to be innovative. He is leading MPS into the future and maintaining our reputation of excellence. The board looks forward to working together in 2017 to continue the momentum of our district as we continue to meet and exceed the needs of all students through our instruction, financial goals, bond projects, and communication with students, employees, parents, and the community at large. Thank you. All right.
Well, first of all, I'd like to make a comment, Angela. Okay. Now, there's a key line you read in there, the hard work of many.
Yes.
And so the superintendent's evaluation really is a reflection of many, many, many people in the district. And I'd start with our students, you know, without their efforts and the quality of our students, certainly would not be getting that evaluation. Our teaching staff, our support staff, those that you surround me with immediately, including the seven of you, allow me to have that evaluation. And I'll make a comment that one of my mentors once said to me, as a superintendent, you're going to get way too much credit and you get way too much blame. And so I'm getting way too much credit tonight. And I'll take the blame later on. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I make a motion?
Yes.
I move to endorse Mike's endorsement or evaluation as read.
All right.
Second.
Okay, Jerry. Support by Scott. Did I hear you?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. At this time, are there any other comments?
Great job, Mike.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mike.
Really appreciate the extensive leadership and the data analysis you do to make good decisions, and the people that you bring in to surround yourself for that, and your leadership not only in the community, but in Lansing as well. Your voice is respected, and we appreciate that as well.
All right, yes, and once again, thank you. And Mike and I sat down the other day and went through this and had good discussion. And so, yes, it was pleasure to write, and it was great when we pulled together all board members' thoughts, how along the same lines we all coming in it from different angles, still all had the same exemplary assessment of your performance here. And thank you once again for joining our district and all the hard work that you continue to do.
I'll thank the employees tomorrow.
All right, at this time, all in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
All opposed? All right. Next up would be you, Mike.
Yes. So we have Neola is our policy carrier assistant in our board policy, and these are board policies that you approved many last month, but I held these back because I needed our technology department to review before we brought them forward to you. You have them today, and they're all standard policy against that are required based on law or practices for technology, website, ADA compliance, network safety, those type of things that we all read but probably don't fully understand. So we had technology review that, and we're ready for your approval tonight.
All right. This time I'll entertain a motion.
I move to adopt those policies as stipulated 4.2.
Second.
All right. Moved by Jerry, supported by Pam. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. Policy revisions pass. Next up, item 5 is request to address the board. Did we have anyone? Is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the board today? All right. Then we can move on to item 6.0, which is our curriculum instruction and assessment. Looks like we have minutes from the last CIA meeting on November 21st. Lynn?
Yep, we do. We met at the, hold on, Midland High Media Center Learning Coach Office. No, I thought we met here, but didn't we?
I think you're reading the minutes from before.
No, right minutes, wrong location.
Okay.
Oh, yep. I thought, wait a minute.
Good catch.
Yeah. We discussed two major change proposals were presented to the committee by Penny Miller-Nelson and Scott Cochran. Algebra 8, the proposal will change the name of the current Algebra 8 to Algebra A. Currently, the NCAA does not recognize Algebra 8 as a core subject course that counts toward the 16 required credits. This name change will resolve this concern and portray that the course meets the same standards as a high school algebra course. Project Lead the Way Launch. The proposal will integrate 24 Project Lead the Way Launch units throughout the K-5 curriculum. These units will serve as a core foundation of STEM instruction for all elementary schools within MPS. Units revolve around the themes of biomedical sciences, computer programming, and engineering. Central Park Elementary will implement all units in the fall of 2017. The remaining 5 elementary schools will implement the units beginning the fall of 2018. Next, the CIA committee was emailed information regarding a third major change proposal following the meeting, French 2 and German 2. The proposal creates the addition of a 0.3 option to French 2 and German 2. Currently, these courses are only designated as a 0.2 class. Students in consultation with their teachers, counselors, and parents would choose whether they want to take French 2 or German 2 as a 0.2 course or as a 0.3 level course. This proposal does not add an additional course. 0.2 and 0.3 would be taught in the same class. This proposal mirrors the same change that occurred in French 1 and German 1 during the 16-17 school year. These three major change proposals are being presented tonight for the 28-day examination period. We then discussed accountability scorecards. A brief overview of school and district scorecard data was presented due to time constraints. A more in-depth presentation on the data is planned for a future CIA meeting. We adjourned at 4 o'clock, and we will meet again in January.
All right. Thank you very much.
Hey, Angela, this might be a perfect example, since you're going to act on some of those notes next, to explain maybe sometimes we get questions about how the board takes action tonight, but very little dialogue, because so much of this dialogue actually happens in these committee meetings. This
yes.
is a perfect example where you have major change proposals that were discussed
right.
in committee, and then tonight you're just going to take action on them.
Well, so actually, I think this is just for the
information.
Examination period, right?
Right, right.
We're not actually taking
for information
action
tonight.
Right, yeah. right.
So it's a good example of how we process from committee to board information to board action.
Right. So I think first there's a group of actually district employees who work on these.
Sure.
And
sure.
then they are brought to the board, to our study committees. So we actually, the board has 4 different study committees, and we meet in general once a month, and we review a lot of information that's going on in the district, and we, you know, take a real in-depth look at things, and the curriculum committee is one of them. And so anything that's changing in the district goes through them. They, you know, can ask questions. They, you know, get a lot of information on it. And then in addition to that, it comes to us, you know, a few days before the board meeting so that we can review and, you know, look at the information. And at that point, you know, even before we get here into a board meeting, we can contact people. We can, you know, find out information to it, you know, about it, ask any questions we have. So that usually by the time we get to the board meeting, we're all pretty well versed in all these things, and we have had time to ask questions and really understand a lot of, you know, what is showing up in these. And then from this point, because we do a 30-day examination period until the next meeting, you know, it will give us another 30 days to also look into this.
So we took all Brian's steam away, but.
Oh, that's okay.
You can add to that, Brian.
I will.
Thank
but
you.
In deference to not providing redundant information, I won't go through the major change proposals again, but I will iterate what you said about multiple layers involving these major change proposals. Before they get to CIA, we actually have an internal vetting committee as well, too, mm-hmm. made up of teachers and administrators that reflects many, many hours of hard work putting these proposals together before they even get to our CIA subcommittee. So by the time that they actually get to the Board of Education for the informational period, they've gone through multiple layers of review and has been vetted by multiple parties as well, too. So many thanks go out to the hard work to the people that put their time and effort into these major change proposals. Number two, I'd like to emphasize and extend our gratitude to the local foundations for making the Project Lead the Way launch proposal even possible for the board's consideration for action at the next meeting. Usually we list specific dollars amounts, but the Project Lead the Way is being funded by the local area foundations. It's a proposal that comprises several hundred thousand dollars of funding to make happen, which would be very difficult to do if we didn't have the support of the foundation. So thank you to the foundations, and again, thank you to all the people that have put multiple hours of time into making these proposals appear tonight before you.
Thank you. I think it's interesting, recently I've been reading articles about other school districts that are implementing Project Lead the Way. There's an article today about the Ann Arbor Public Schools receiving some foundation money, and even my own school district that I graduated from, through their school foundation, they had an article about implementing some Project Lead the Way. So it was interesting to see how many other districts are also realizing the importance of doing that type of learning and getting involved in that. All right. This time we will move into finance, facilities, and operations. Once again, another committee we meet once a month. Spend a lot of time meeting and going through a lot of things. And this time we met on December 12th. So Jerry,
We actually have an arrears one of them because our board meeting timing
wasn't quite right.
So I have the November 21st. Mr. Dombro and Mr. Jerome shared and discussed with the committee the timelines, the bid deadlines and bid awards, design work, construction progress on the various projects and what's coming forward in the future. Tons of detail there, not gonna elaborate now as we talked about just earlier. On the December 12th meeting, the committee reviewed and discussed district financial projections and their impact on future employee group agreements. Again, lots of detail. That's it.
Thank you. All right, moving into Bob.
Yep. Just for information tonight only, but like always, not just Christmas season around here, you know, the gifts are always pretty nice. We have totaling, I think there's 23 if I counted correctly, $17,824.99. And it is a wide variety. I think sometimes when I look at the gift list, if you wonder what's happening in different places around the district, you can really get a handle on some of the individual buildings and what they're doing. And so, for example, there's $600 here for our JCC for Thanksgiving dinner baskets that came from the Bergstein Fund, from the Midland County Bergstein Fund. We have some money from the Music Boosters Club, the Midland Area Community Foundation. You'll see quite a few there because of the nonviolent activities. You'll see a lot of the buildings, and they use their $250 in different ways as you go down that list. You'll see some Spanish students at Jefferson taking a trip with Kellogg Youth Funding. Our Community Gives, where our teams and students go out, perform community service, and in return through Dow Chemical and the Midland Area Community Foundation, they get money back for their programs. You'll see quite a few there. As you can tell, that's a $1,000 award each time they do that. We have boosters clubs both high school. This month we have the Delhi Booster Club giving gifts. At Jefferson, we have the JPAC, the Parent Advisory Committee, and you'll see a couple there. And this month, especially, quite a few from the American Chemical Society, which they do for guest chemists and for lab supplies, science supplies at the various schools. So like always, very appreciative. And also, like always, we'll run those at the end of this meeting on television so you can see the actual sponsors, who got the money, and how much money those were.
All right. Thank you. And thanks to all the community members who provide all the extras for our district. So appreciative. Moving into human resources.
We did not have a committee meeting, so 1 minute's there.
All right.
But we do have, we'd like to express the sympathy to two of our families who've lost Midland Public Schools former employees. Ms. Peggy Porter, who passed away on November 18th. Ms. Porter was an MPS office professional at Midland High for 26 years, retiring in 2009. And Mr. Herman Hill, who passed away on December 11th. Mr. Hill was a math teacher at Northeast Intermediate School for 32 years, retiring in 1992. Mr. Hill was a 1975 recipient of the Gerstacker Award for Excellence in Teaching.
So I do want to make one comment. Mr. Hill was my seventh grade math teacher, and I think I had referenced before that middle school was when I finally, you know, really hit home for me that I really liked math and I was good at math. And
he's a guy.
I had him for seventh grade math, and wonderful. You just never know what's going to spark a student. And now I'm an engineer.
Yep.
There you go.
Anyway, that was very sad when I read of his passing. All right, item 9, correspondence to and from the Board of Education. You can read those. And then 10 would be follow-up on our next scheduled activities. Our next regular meeting will be January 16th, 2017. This will be our organizational meeting. And I think we do that first for like a half hour, followed by our regular board meeting. And then you can see the rest of the dates in there, all tentative, based on our approval at the organizational meeting. At this time, we will move into our study discussion session, hearing from board members. So, Patrick, we'll start with you.
First, huh? All right. Shining stars, every month I'm impressed to hear what's going on. It hit me tonight with both Mrs. DeGroat and Ms. Lasky, especially Mrs. Lasky. She's been with the district for 2 years longer than I've been alive. That kind of dedication, she must enjoy her job. To be that long, dedicate your life to this, I really appreciate those type of efforts. Still makes your school special. Electronics Club, again, that was every month I think I see my favorite presentation. And then I get to the next month and I hear something even better. But a few key words tonight I think it was Andrew mentioning, this club combined all of his science and math and physics into one project that he liked to do, you know, something applicable and something practical instead of just being a theoretical, science class. Andrew also said, he mentioned project-based learning, which is big to hear our students grasping those concepts that we're trying to get through. So awesome to hear. Mr. Clippa's time, again, those kind of volunteers what make these schools special. Hearing him talk, I want to join myself, to be honest, that club and see what I'd like to be around for that. Thanks to Mike again for your review. I appreciate all the work and time. I know Angela said it well tonight, but I do appreciate it. And that's it for me tonight.
I got online and looked at the new videos for Central Elementary, and it's fabulous. So if you get a chance, check that out. I did notice on our website, too, that we have an application period for School of Choice, February 1st to the 28th, for that Central Park Elementary. And I had someone asking me about that this week, so I thought it was great. It's up on the websites. And I just a shout out for people to check out our websites on all of the schools. I've just been real impressed with how they look, how easy they are to navigate. There's a ton of information on any subject you could possibly want to know about the schools, and it's just real easy to get to. So hopefully our parents and students are using that great tool. Last-minute Christmas gift ideas, Central Park Elementary, donate $50 or more, and you can get your name or name of a loved one engraved on a wall, and what a great gift. And they can't take it back, so that's even better. Thank you to all the students and staff that donated their time, their talent, or something something else this holiday season. So many of our elementary, middle, and high school students were involved in giving back to the community and doing something for themselves just because, and or for someone else just because. And I thought that was wonderful. I also saw on the website the bid invitations for Central Auditorium and the elementary renovations, and it's just more excitement to come. A big thank you to our presenters tonight, to K-E-A-E-0-U, Brendan and Natalie, and our volunteers, and Mr. Fawcett as well. What a neat, neat opportunity, and not only at the high school, but really expanding to the middle school as well. So we've got a lot to be thankful for.
Well, I wasn't going to say anything, but being me, I guess I can't, and my chief advisor called a wife, said, you have to. So I am going to say something in my last board meeting. 2003, 13 and a half years ago, a whole generation of K through 12 students, and that's how long I've served on the Board of Education for Midland Public Schools. It's been a surface of love. Education has, for a very long time, been my thing. I take great joy in helping people learn. Training at Dow, Legacy Center Tutoring, School Board, most of my service has been towards helping others learn. But tonight I'm going to turn the tables a little bit and be a little bit selfish and say what I've learned over 13 and a half years. I've learned that every kid has an innate desire to be curious and learn new things, to grow and to explore. That's why I'm so excited about our STEM direction and facilities. Kids will explore, their curiosity will be piqued at school, a wonderful thing. I've learned community attitudes to education are critical to student success. To provide the means and emotional encouragement of academic success plays a very large role in how students perceive school and their need to learn. We in Midland are very blessed with a community whose attitude is that education is not only important, but essential to a good community. I've learned teachers are blessed people and have a very special impact on our youth. Outside of parents and very close family, it is frequently a teacher that we think of when asked who guided us, who created a career interest, who taught us a life lesson or two, or who helped us through troubled times. We in Midland are very blessed with wonderful teachers whom most of our students find with fondness later in life. I've learned that parents are the key to academic success. Without them, the best district, the best teachers, the best community support will not result in great student outcomes. It is fundamental to student success. The rest of us are here to assist them and provide the means to educate their children, and that's where our responsibility lies. We in Midland are very blessed to have such caring and dedicated parents. Go to any school event if you don't believe me. Parents are there in throng, support, and encourage not only their child, but all the kids participating. Kids see and feel this. When I officiated football, we officiated a varsity game in a nearby district that had 10. I counted them because it was really easy. 10 parents of adults, I should say 10 adults in the stands for the home team. So you could sense on the field how the kids were not enthused to be there at all, were totally flat, and their performance reflected that. The same holds true, maybe more so, for academics in the arts. Our kids feel how we feel about their activities and success. So I've learned in those 13 years that giving parents a reason to be excited about their schools, to be proud of their schools, means a lot in how our students perceive their schools. I hope Midland never loses how the grown-ups feel about their schools and education. It will serve our youth immeasurably. I've learned that hiring good people is essential to the success of the service we provide our parents in educating their children. That's what we do, provide service to educate children. We hire good people. I've been blessed, or at least think it was a blessing, to be president twice when we hired new superintendents. As you have heard tonight, each were and are great leaders for MPS at the time of their incumbency. They led us through some very perilous times, such that Midland had never seen before. They did that with students being the first and last thought in the decision making. I will stand tall leaving tonight knowing these gentlemen led us in a way that sustained this district, strengthened it, and positioned it extremely well for the future. I've learned what good board members are all about. I've heard horror stories of boards with infighting, single interest members, factions, et cetera, et cetera. Schools absolutely cannot be effective with that sort of leadership. Good people will be scared away, superintendents, staff, teachers, and parents. I know from experience how a board can become distracted by such behavior. I hope you as board members continue the tradition of excellent boardsmanship in Midland. I've learned much from the wisdom and guidance of former board members. Dick Dolinsky, who encouraged me to run and whom I've had the pleasure of serving with, is not only a mentor and friend, but someone I try to emulate in my board actions and decisions. Nothing honored me more than to speak at a recent community event and have someone introduce me as the next generation Dick Dolinsky. I was humbled and honored beyond belief. Rick Oley, who served longer than I did, was a board member relied upon heavily during his tenure and after for advice and counsel, both of which were outstanding and wise through those years. Thanks, Rick, for mentoring and guiding me all those years. And to all you board members here tonight, especially Lynn, Yvonne, Scott, and Angela, said, help me when I was president as we sailed some pretty treacherous waters together and emerged stronger and better because of that. So thank you. I've learned from you. I'm excited where we're heading. In a few short years, I truly believe that we'll be a beacon in Michigan and nationally for STEM education. I cannot think of a more appropriate community for this to come forth. If this is my legacy, I will wear it with pride and honor. I've learned my dear children and wife have sacrificed for me to be on the board. The number of hours away, the pressure of a high school child of a board member in school is not to be understated. I appreciate their patience with me and their listening and understanding as we stressed over some very difficult decisions at this table that would be directly impacting them. So I've learned much during my academic career here on the MPS Board of Education. I just hope future students, those for whom I have served, will learn just as much over their time at MPS. So it's time to say goodbye, but not farewell. It's a sad time for me, can't deny that. But I leave feeling I've left a positive influence. Excuse me. But I leave feeling I left a positive influence on this community and stand by to serve MPS in any capacity it deems necessary in the future as education's in my blood. So my sincere thanks to all of you, to all current and past board members, to the three superintendents I've worked closely with, to all the many teachers who have shared their concerns and ideas, to the multitude of parents who insist on talking about schools at any social event I've attended the past 13 years, and to thousands of students I may have impacted in the past countless ones and the countless ones in the future. So MPS, thank you, thank you, thank you for teaching and educating me all these years. It's a debt of gratitude I can never repay. Thank you.
Angela, I think you should go next. I go out of order.
All right. So we do both? All right. At this time, because yes, Jerry, we could not let you go without talking about you and Yvonne. At this time, I would like to read a resolution for Yvonne. This is a resolution recognizing the contribution of Ms. Yvonne Gorton to the education of children at Midland Public Schools in Midland, Michigan. Whereas Ms. Yvonne Gorton has served on the Midland Public School Board of Education from 2012 through 2016. Whereas during her tenure on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, Ms. Gorton served as board trustee and board secretary. Whereas Ms. Gorton has served on numerous boards and committees during her term with the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, adding significant views and insights as topics were discussed, recommendations were formulated, and decisions were made. Whereas throughout her years of service, Ms. Gorton has made an invaluable contribution to education in Midland, Michigan, always focusing the best interest of all students. Therefore, be it resolved the Midland Public Schools Board of Education formally recognizes Ms. Yvonne Gorton for her 5 years of dedication to the children of Midland Public Schools through her avid, committed service on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, dated this 19th day of December, 2016. Thank you so much, Yvonne.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Yvonne and I were elected Yvonne and I were elected the same year, although I was a partial term, which is why now we're offset, but it has been such a pleasure serving with you.
Well, thank you.
Every single time we've ever been together, there's no doubt that you do this out of your love for the district and for all the students.
Thank you so much. It's been an honor and a pleasure.
Great. To give you this part of it.
Thank you very much.
All right. This time I have a second resolution. This is a resolution recognizing the contribution of Mr. Gerald Wasserman to the education of children at Midland Public Schools, Midland, Michigan. Whereas Mr. Jerry Wasserman has served on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education from 2003 through 2016, whereas during his tenure on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, Mr. Wasserman served as board president for 5 years, vice president for 2 years, secretary for 2 years, and treasurer for 3 years. Whereas Mr. Wasserman played a key role in the passage of the 2.95 mil bond passage in February of 2015, Mr. Wasserman made countless community presentations, answered numerous questions, and participated in many focus groups and meetings. Whereas Mr. Wasserman served as board president during two successful superintendent searches, which resulted in the hiring of preeminent leaders for Midland Public Schools. Whereas Mr. Wasserman has selflessly served on numerous boards and committees during his tenure with the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, his longevity, dedication, and insightful service to the Finance, Facilities, and Operations Committee in particular has been especially noteworthy, astute, and truly valued. Therefore, be it resolved, the Midland Public Schools Board of Education formally recognizes Mr. Gerald Wasserman for his 14 years of dedication to all children of Midland Public Schools through his passionate, committed service on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, dated this 19th day of December, 2016.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh,
okay.
Thank you.
It's got velcro on it, too.
Thank you. It's very kind.
No, thank you, Jerry. Jerry has been such a mentor to so many, especially to me. In taking this on, I could have never become president of the board without you, Jerry. And I so appreciate all your guidance and your help and everything that you've done for this district.
Thank you.
No doubt that everything you do is done because you just love the district and you want what's best for kids.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks, all of you.
And as I assured Mike, I live in between Dick Dolinsky and Jerry Wasserman. So we're good.
So we're covered.
All right.
Good luck following that.
Yeah, no kidding. Jerry, I knew you were not going out quietly tonight.
I was till 9 o'clock this morning.
You're up and down. I'm sneaking out of here.
9 o'clock this morning. I was. No, you're not.
Oh, man. Thank you, both of you, so much. It's been a pleasure for the last 4 years serving with you guys. not to add, it's hard to add to everything that's already been said, but you both have been great mentors and just a really, truly an honor getting to know both of you. And I wish you both very well in the future. And I'm sure we'll be talking very soon. And please keep in touch. And we will continue to rely on you as we move forward with all these different projects. Also, everybody forgot the cards. So thank you to Adams for this wonderful card. I don't know if they're all the same from Adams. It looks like they might be.
They look a little bit different.
We have Olivia McGrath from 6th grade Northeast Middle School. The camera, I can't get on these, but what a great design. And then we have Siebert Elementary gave us all a Christmas card. So thank you to those schools and those students for thinking of us during the holiday season. That's all I have.
Yes, tonight is also my last meeting, and I would like to say that 5 years ago, 5 years seemed like a lot longer than it does tonight looking back, but during those 5 years, I think a lot of very exciting things have happened, not the least of which was our ability to convince Mr. Sherrow to come here and be our superintendent. I thought it was a good idea at the time, and I remain convinced that it was a very good idea, and I think I'm certainly not alone. Based on your evaluation. So I have really enjoyed working with you. It's been a pleasure, and I thank you for everything. And I wish you continued success, and I'm sure you will have continued success. I mean, based on what we've seen, I think things are going to be great. And Cindy, I don't know how you do everything you do, but you do. And so thank you so much for everything you've done. I really appreciate it. Bob and Brian, it's been great working with you. Congratulations to Brad Blazek and Mary Friedel, and I hope your next 4 years are as exciting and as rewarding as my last five have been. I hope you enjoy it as much as I have. I've learned tremendously. I've met some just exceptionally nice people and some really, really great leaders. And one of those really great leaders, of course, is Jerry Wasserman. I think I've... you know, just talking with Jerry and serving on this board with Jerry has just been such a learning experience and has really taught me so much. And I thank you for everything, Jerry. Thank you for your leadership. I've, you know, had bosses I didn't respect as much as I do you or didn't learn as much from as I do you. So
hopefully they're not watching.
I thought about that.
She said had. Right. Past tense.
Yeah, and I thought about that and decided I'll let them watch. And big thank you to my fellow board members. Again, I've learned so much from all of you, and I've really enjoyed being on this board with you. It's just been a really rewarding experience, really great experience. And I'd like to say, again, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank teachers in the Midland Public Schools. I think they are one of the most professional groups of teachers I've ever met. I have always said, and I still feel, that I am very, very grateful that my daughters had the opportunity to be educated in the Midland Public Schools. I think that will serve them well all their lives. I'm very grateful for that. And so I guess I'll just wrap it up by saying thank you, everybody. It's been a wonderful experience. It really has been a very gratifying experience. I would recommend it to anybody. I mean, I think it's just been a really great learning experience, and I've met so many nice people, and it's just been really exciting. And the, you know, the STEM school, what in the world is more exciting than that? I mean, I think that is just awesome, and I just can't wait till it's done, and the kids are going there every day. That's going to be great. So thank you all very much, and I hope everybody has very happy holidays.
Wow, this is hard to follow all of you. Well, I will first say thank you to Jerry and Yvonne. Jerry and I go way, way back, and I know he's a big shoulder for me to lean on a lot of times, and I learned a lot from you, Jerry, and I appreciate everything that you've done for so many people and students, and we're going to rely on you in the future. I'll miss you. And Yvonne, I've known you for a long time, and
That's
I know
true.
How passionate you are for children and our love of the Midland Public Schools. So thank you, and I wish you well as also.
Thank you, Lynn.
And then the Shining Stars, the Sarah and Vivian, and every month the people that a lot of us don't ever see in action, and they're the part of what makes Midland Public Schools so wonderful, as well as the Electronics Club and the students involved in those, and volunteers and staff. We just have so many things to be proud of. And with Mike's leadership and
the support we get from him, and we support him and the staff here. It's no wonder we do such great things, as Angela alluded to in the letter to Mike and in his valuation. And when I saw some of those numbers, you know, the top 5% or what was it today? There was something number one and number six in your Monday letter today. Mm-hmm. There's just so many awesome things that are happening in Midland Public Schools. And I know Pam mentioned all the projects that students are doing, from our little ones all the way through high school, to the generosity to give back to others. And you can't ask more than that when you're raising children, to be able to give back. Those are important life skills along with the academics. Let's see if I have anything else. I think that's it. Thank you for the Christmas cards, and I wish everyone a nice, relaxing break and a very Merry Christmas. And we look forward to the new year and what everything's going to bring us then with the STEM school and just all the exciting activities that we'll all look forward to in 2017.
Before I bring us back to business, you guys got to know all superintendents tell stories about their board members, and I'm sure all board members tell stories about their superintendents. But I'm only going to tell two of them tonight because they're not going to be my evaluators anymore.
It's going to haunt us, Yvonne.
Well, two memories. My first impressions of Jerry and Yvonne, and so when the search firm originally had called me about the position here, you know, I've told the story hundreds of times that I first said, no, I don't really want to change, you know, I really don't want to leave where I'm at. And when they tried to convince me, Dave Peterson said to me, have you watched the Midland Public School board meetings yet? And you were going through some difficult times at that time, if you recall. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I've watched a little bit. And he said, have you watched the president of the board and how he maneuvers through the board meeting and what he's done? And so he said, call me back after you watch a few more. So I can watch the board meeting and call him back and try to get in at that point in time. And that's a tribute to Jerry's leadership and, you know, what he was dealing with at that time. They promised me you would take care of, and you did within 30 days of my arrival, which was very good. And then the night that you decided to hire me, I watched the board meeting. I think Bob Cooper has mentioned it multiple times to me, and I really think Yvonne was the one that just kind of pushed you all to hire me. It was the comments Yvonne said that kind of everybody summed it up. And so Yvonne, from that moment on, I kind of said, okay, I've got one in my fan group. And so two impressions of both of you, and I certainly appreciate your support and what you've done. And it is a calling. I mean, what we do in education, and you are part of the family of education. You're educators at this point. And what we do is a calling. You know, the rest of it, you see young teachers come in this profession just about on a poverty wage today. There's a reason they accept this profession and the challenges of it, and it's the calling. And when you're all done, like the gentleman we honored tonight with that Angela had, there's the purpose of what we do. And so appreciate your service. And you're not done serving, as I've told both of you. I'll be calling on you for different things, guaranteed, as we go forward. So back to school business. Our community is so supportive, and if you know, for a while we've been struggling with Bravo, our volunteer. We have so many volunteers, we literally don't know how to manage them. Mm-hmm. And so we have lost the Bravo coordinator recently as well, and in discussions with United Way and Ann Fillmore, a discussion with Ann, suddenly, if you know Ann, turns into a discussion. Ann's going to try to solve our problem. She talks to Rob Valentin, the Dow Chemical Company steps up, and they've given us a grant to hire a coordinator, and Ann's going to be also part of the process. It'll be a United Way employee who will also be part of the process of helping us improve our Bravo system. And so, as I wrote to you and told you, that Bravo makeover is starting in January, and so we'll have an employee on hand at that point in time. We'll keep you up to date who that is, but it's very exciting to get that kind of support to try to organize our volunteers. And part of it comes from Central Park. We've talked about volunteers going there. If we don't organize them well, and possibly even train them well, they actually become a burden a little bit to teachers. And so it's another person in the classroom to manage, and we don't need that to go going forward. And so I have great hope that's going to clean some of that up and make it a better process, and all that support that we received, great. I see Mark Hackbirth in the crowd today, and so I'll be careful with my words, Mark. I'm always careful, Mark, because I'm sure Mark follows him closely. Mark and I met kind of informally one day, and we talked about maybe doing a bargaining process a little different, and maybe starting where we ended last time in the last process. And that was a good process, and we completed that process before school was out, which was good, I think, if I remember right, Mark. Kind of went into another proposal recently. The teachers presented one back to us the other day. We're going to meet tomorrow for half a day, and I think both Mark and I have high hopes that we probably can reach an agreement. We'll see how that goes, but I think we have high hopes we could reach agreement. If we did that before January 1st, that'd be amazing. So going forward, so I think pretty fair proposal we got on the table for both parties, and so we'll see where we go with some details with that for you. Keep you up to date on that. Lame duck is over. I think we all can celebrate that. It was not a real busy lame duck, thank God for school, but I caution you on celebrating too much. Mm-hmm. You know, thanks for all the phone calls everyone made, but let's be honest about what partly happened there. You got a Republican governor, Republican House, Republican Senate, and those agenda topics that they want, they didn't have to be in a hurry for. They're all coming back. Mm-hmm. And so we expect MIPSERS to be back on the table. We expect several of those, that income tax shift, as you might call, which it was might be the one that concerns me the most at this point in time. If you saw the amount of revenue that would now be gone out of the school aid fund, that would have to get in line with everyone else's needs in order to get those money, that's a bit scary. So we need to really work on that one, I think, maybe the most going forward. So we need to pay attention and continue to lobby Lansing and our local legislators as well. Bond update, as Pam said, the bids are out for request on Woodcrest and Plymouth renovations, full renovations on those, the finishing of the auditorium as well. So we'll have those back for you. It's going to be a very fast week when we get those bids in January. So we're because of the timelines, we kind of had to redraw some things and do some things differently. And so we're pushed on those. And so we're probably going to close those, have bids to educate you like on a Thursday. So I'm probably going to either be calling you or writing you on Thursday, Friday, and then expect you to take action on those bids on Monday. We'll probably even bring Daryl in at that point, Daryl Dunbar from Barton Mallow, to talk just a little bit more discussion maybe on those bids as we go forward. But you know, as you know, we've been pretty good. We've been able to get low bids or local bids that are near low, and so go forward with those. So it's going to be busy there. And then in January, your secure entrances are going out to bid. Mm-hmm. And technology, Bob? I think it was the other one, right, in technology?
Yeah, the STEM Center.
It's STEM School would be going out as well. We're going to act on those real quick in February as well to get those moving. So heading into a busy spring, summer, and your approval of those is the first step going forward. And I think I had one other piece here. Central Park visits. As you know, we've taken quite a few people through Central Park. Most recently, about 15, what we call community leaders. We invited more, but we had about 15 go through. And we had our two local legislators, I think, was important as well. I think they really saw what we're trying to create there. If you go in there at this point in time, you can see these open spaces. You can see the hands-on, project-based, the different learning style, and I think they're pretty excited about what they saw there. Maybe we can continue to work on Mr. Glenn and Mr. Stamos about maybe when we open that school, we could invite the governor out. What do you think? And see if we can't get the governor back to Midland like he was here a couple of years ago and show him that special school. So. Pretty neat piece on that as well. And that's all I have.
All right, thank you. Does anyone else have anything? All right. So I wish everyone a wonderful holiday. Time off, get some rest. And then thanks once again to Yvonne and Jerry for all your service.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Mm-hmm. All right. And with that,
thank you all. Good night.